Greetings again, friends. So now we're going to look at the life cycle of salmon and steelhead. Let's do a little overview. So we have five main stages of their life cycle. The first is egg. The second is fry. Next comes smolt, then adult, and then a spawner. We're going to go into detail on all of these. So first, let's look at the development from egg to fry. Here is a very nice visual diorama of coho salmon eggs that have been preserved. When adult salmon come back to spawn, they lay their eggs in a nest, which we call a red, R-E-D-D. Here you can see freshly laid eggs. They have been fertilized, and these would be down in the gravel below the surface of the water. Next we have, you can see them develop and begin to eye up. If you can actually see in there, black, those black dots are actually the fish's eye. And you can see the white is actually their spine and their tail starting to form. They continue to form a little bit more here and hatch. And so there you can see a little fish head and body, but mostly still the egg sac. These are called alevins. And they continue to absorb that egg sac, the yolk sac, as their very first nutrients. Here you can see that their egg sac is almost completely absorbed. And at this point, the fish will actually begin to migrate up out of the gravel into the river. And once they're out of the nest, they are called fry. So a fun fact, and one of the favorite parts of my job, is when we get to go out into the rivers and actually collect eggs to bring back into our conservation facility. We do this only in watersheds where the fish are on the verge of extinction. And so what we do is we take a big water pump, hydraulic pump, and we use that water to blast the eggs out of the gravel. And just downstream of that, we have a basket which catches the eggs, and then a net just in case some of those eggs sneak through our basket. It's really cool, and it's a great way to get these eyed eggs into our facility. And remember, when they're eyed, they're very durable, so they can handle all of the movement and the bouncing around and jostling that they will experience. So now we're going to talk about fry. Not French fries, these are fish fry. So the fish swim up and out of the gravel, and they are little teeny tiny fish, and they're eating very small aquatic insects, so bugs that are found in the water. Once they're big enough and strong enough, they actually swim out and utilize the estuaries where they feed and continue to get stronger as they move up and out into the open ocean. Now, some species of salmon, like the chum, will only spend about a month, not even, in the freshwater before they migrate out. They'll spend a little more time in the estuaries, which is why our estuary health is so important. Other species, however, like the steelhead, spend up to 2 years in the freshwater. So during that time of growth between fry, we call them par before they graduate to smolts. And remember, these fish have to tolerate quite a huge change in their bodies and their environment as they swim from freshwater into saltwater. I guess in humans it would be maybe like breathing a whole different kind of air. So the next phase of the life history of the salmonid is the smolt phase. Now, this is typically a time when they shed their skin and grow a new set of scales. And so once this transition has happened and they're ready to leave the freshwater and go to the saltwater, we call them smolting. And they start this journey called the outmigration. Now, this is the phase of the steelhead life history that we are following in Survive the Sound. So what happens is we capture wild steelhead as they are leaving their home river, and we implant them with a small tag called an acoustic tag. And then following them through Puget Sound, we have all of these different receivers that connect with that tag. And so we can determine how far these fish are making it, how successful they are at avoiding predators and other obstacles, and then which one will be the winner. So once the steelhead and other species of salmonids have survived the sound or they're out migration, they swim out into the open ocean. All species migrate and perform a little differently in the ocean as far as their behaviors, but all of them are out in the ocean to feast. You can find schools of fish from Alaska down to California. They spend usually 2 to 4 years out in the open ocean just feasting. So once they start their home migration, these fish have gone a long way from where they were born. And typically, most every salmonid will return to the exact same river, almost the exact same location in that river where it was born. That's a long way. So how do they make it? They don't have a map, they don't have GPS. What they're doing is they're actually smelling their way home. They have a nerve in their brain called their olfactory nerve. And this allows them to actually smell the very, very minuscule differences in the water to get back to their exact river. It's absolutely fascinating. And think about it, this was a long journey out, and now it's going to be equally as a long journey home. And now they're bigger, and so more predators might see them. They have all these obstacles to avoid. Eventually, they make it back to their river. Once they hit the freshwater, their bodies start to change. One, they are sexually mature, so they're ready to spawn. The males typically develop a big jaw, big crooked jaw with teeth, and so they can use those to defend and to fight off other males while they're trying to spawn with the female. The females will typically maintain a nice, gentle, smaller physique than the males. And like we mentioned earlier, the pink salmon will develop a great big huge hump on their back. Now, the fish, all of the salmonids, enter the freshwater and they have a ways to go until they find their spawning location. They're looking for nice gravel with good water flow. And once the female, who is the one that's looking for the nest location, has found this spot, and she does this by probing her pelvic fin down into the water about the surface of the gravel to make sure that there's enough water flow for her eggs to incubate. During this time, the males are schooling up around her, and typically there'll be a few. And it's usually the biggest, meanest, most dominant male that will be the one that sits by her side on the red. So then she begins digging the nest, and she uses her tail and will lay on her side and just use her tail to move the gravel and create this depression in which she will lay her eggs. At this point, it's very common to see the dominant male, while he's still fighting and chasing away other males, swim up beside her and almost do this little shaky quiver. And that's part of their courtship. And then when the nest is dug and all ready for the eggs, she will release her eggs, and as they're dropping down into the nest, he will release his milt, and the eggs are fertilized in a flash as they settle down into that pit. And then the hard-working female uses her tail and covers up the nest. It all happens in the flash of an eye and is very, very remarkable. And just like that, the life cycle begins again. It really is a remarkable thing to observe, but it relies upon healthy habitat and ample food available for all of the fish at every stage of their life.